starting my talk, I want to pay an homage to Bill Collins, who died very recently. He was 70 years old, and when I saw him in September in Italy, in Assisi, he looked good, you know? I was really surprised at what happened, you know? I'm sorry. Anyway, let me tell you a few words about what he's done, you know? First of all, he was a supporter of cold fusion from day one. He had a very good knowledge of nuclear reaction. I mean, he developed his own software about calculation of masses and energy by a different reaction you could make with everything in the table of elements. He was really against the DD reaction that everybody is supporting. That's a good thing to do. Everybody should not be this of same opinion anyway, so that's good. Also, he was a great supporter of two very interesting people, John Fisher and Yuri Pazutov. Both of them had strange theories. One was with polyneutron theory, and Yuri Pazutov had this Erzion theory, and I still don't know what an Erzion is. I understand polyneutron, but not Erzion. Unfortunately, both passed away, and they are not here to defend their theories anymore. The only one who was defending it was Bill. I also did some experimental work. He partially produced Piantelli's experiment with nickel and hydrogen. When at ICCF10, it was decided to create, it was in Boston, it was decided to create a society. And he was the one who took care of that and put together a lot of the what we will talk about tonight. He's been very active for 20 years with the society. If without him, there would be no society, I think. He was a chief executive officer since then, and he took very good care of the finances of the society. He organized 15 workshops in Italy and in France in exquisite locations. Oh, I don't see the whole thing for some reason. Anyway, that's okay. It's not too bad. He also organized one of the ICCF conferences in Italy 4 years ago. 15 organized. And the thing is, he was very capable because he organized them in very cheap places so that everybody could go at low cost. Everything was included in the price. And he was able to make profit, so society has some funding now. We're not bankrupt at all, better than most of societies. Medals. Also, he was very much into medals, and he invented several medals. The Giuliano Preparata Medal was the successor of the Truffle Prize. You know, at the beginning of the cold fusion, they decided to make it, because I think it was Martin Fleischmann who did that, the Truffle Prize, because truffles are difficult to find, just like cold fusion. So it was the Truffle Prize. Some people had problem with carrying truffles in their suitcase when they're traveling by plane, because it smells so much. Anyway, that was changed to the Preparata Medal, because Giuliano Preparata was a great theoretician, experimentalist also. He did a good, excellent contribution to the field, and unfortunately he died, and under his name, that was his medal, that was awarded to quite a few people, including me. The Minori Toyota Gold Medal was created because Mr. Toyota was very active in the field of cold fusion. He helped Pons and Fleischmann to work in France in their laboratory, and he was really a great person. Unfortunately, when he died, the whole field collapsed in Toyota. This is the Giuliano Preparata Medal, and this is the Minoru Toyota Gold Medal. So, a good state. So let me talk now about something more down to earth, about excess heat. I mean, in this field of cold fusion, demonstration of the effect has been done 34 years ago already. I mean, been replicated and replicated and replicated, but people don't listen to what we are saying. They don't believe us. So at one point, we have to skip scientists and go to engineers and go to the practical solution. So what we need, a lot of excess heat. People don't care about what we found. We found transmutation, we found neutron, we found tritium, we found everything, but they don't care about it. So skip them. I've learned that in my life. Don't try to go above the mountain, go around the mountain, it's easier. You don't have to climb. So my talk, I will have a short introduction, then I will talk about the various calorimeters we have developed during our program at the Clean HNE project, which is a European project dedicated to cold fusion. And I'm very proud to be part of this project. So we have four calorimeters, I will describe them one after the other, and the results we have. So that was the European project Clean HNE. I've talked about it last year in Mountain View. We have developed a material that produces nanoparticles of nickel alloys embedded in aluminum. And with this material, we have shown that we can produce a lot of excess heat. So, we have now, the idea was first to show that this material works, and we have shown it last year, and we have done some more experiments in them with the same calorimeter. But the idea is to increase the amount of material to increase the yield and the total energy produced. Because people don't care about milliwatts, they don't care about watts, they want kilowatts or something like that. I mean, I can understand it. Same thing with euros and dollars, you know, you don't want a few watts. It's more comfortable. Anyway, to measure accurately the anomalous heat, we are using a Cvectide calorimeter. Actually, it was invented by a French scientist called Calvé. Actually, it was from my university in Marseille before I was working there. So the actual word should be Calvé, but most people know it as Cvec because the effect is a Cvec effect. So we have a lot of thermocouples to amplify the signal. Anyway, I will show you that. The basic design is a stainless steel chamber, 150 millimeter long and 63 millimeter in diameter. And we can put inside cells, quartz cells. Why quartz cells? I started with stainless steel cells, but the problem with steel and any metal at high temperature, hydrogen goes through. If you go to, palladium does it at low temperature, but other metals do it at high temperature. The only thing I could find that was really easily usable was quartz. So we use quartz cells now. We have also heat screens to limit the power, the limitation. I mean, the best insulation is vacuum. So we have a vacuum chamber, and then we have screens to limit the radiation. The idea is to get high temperature with low input power. I will show you now, we can go up to 1000 centigrade with low power, which is very important, because to have a good signal to noise ratio. So this is the basic idea of the calorimeter. You can see, and let me see if the mouse works. You see something? I don't see anything. So it doesn't work.
Okay.
That's okay. You can imagine. You can imagine a pointer. So you have this external, you see the thermocouples? Between the thermocouples that are in series, there are 50 thermocouples in series, and one side is in the water bath, and the other side is the hot source. And in the middle is the vacuum chamber. You can see the quartz cells in the middle and the screens. The chamber is made of aluminum, and the reactor chamber is stainless steel. this is a view of the construction of this reactor. There's insulation between the two walls. So the whole thing is in a water bath at 20 centigrade constant temperature. This is the chamber that fits inside. And this is one of the cells, can try different type of cells. In this type of cells, I use a cantal wire wind around the quartz cell and cement to isolate it. And that way I can go to high temperatures. We have different types of cells. This is heated from the outside. And this is the design, the whole thing in the water bath. So we have two types of cells. One heated from the outside on top, and one heated from the inside, at the bottom. I will tell you more about the problem with these cells. Anyway, let me talk about the results. So since last year, we have repeated some of the experiments, tried to improve them with more or less success. So this one, I put my glasses on because, you know, I'm getting older. It doesn't look like that, but I'm getting older. The red curve is a blank. So you see about the resolution of the parameter. And then we have used here a powder of, what is it? How come I can read it? Maybe it's a bar. Is there any way to remove this bar? Oh, I wrote up the same thing here and there. That's all right. So I should read here. This is nickel iron mixture. I don't know whether there is this bar here. Yeah, I can use it. It does. Is it visible now? Okay. Oh, you can see it. Great. Okay, it's a nickel iron mixture. We started with nickel copper because our Japanese friends used nickel copper, so we copied the Japanese groups. And so we started with nickel copper. But then we tried different materials, and this one is with iron. And you can see the. I think I'm not very good with computers. I'm too old for this. I couldn't see the mouse. Anyway, the red curve is a blank. Then when I put hydrogen in it, in the powder, you can see the blue curve. And you see there is a threshold around 550, 600 degrees where excess heat appears. Then what's interesting is that when I evacuate the chamber, the excess heat increases a little bit. You see the green curve above. So there's more heat when I remove the hydrogen. Then I go back to room temperature, put hydrogen again, and go up again. And then you have the black curve. And then when I remove the hydrogen, you have the dashed red curve. So interesting, every time you do a cycle, it seems that you're increasing the excess heat. In this experiment, there are only two cycles. I will show you more cycles in the future. Okay, now this one is due to the talk of my good friend Lynn Bowen at the workshop last year, where she said this reaction should be activated by radiations. So the only active radiation I could get was thorium oxide. So I don't know if that was good enough, but I tried to mix the nickel copper with thorium oxide. So there was, I don't know the proportions, I just took a number. 12 grams of nickel copper and 3 grams of thorium oxide. I don't know if it is a good number. Maybe Lynn will give me more details about that. Anyway, so we did that, and you see the results here. We have done 3 cycles, one of them with deuterium. I mean, the first two with hydrogen, the third one with deuterium, going vacuum again. And the result is not that impressive. It's only 0.8 watts maximum we get. And there is in the past reactions, the reaction were going up with temperature. This one, there seems to be an optimum around 750, 800 degrees. I don't know why, 700 degrees. So there's a difference there. So maybe I have to talk to Lynn to see if maybe thorium oxide is not a good material to put. We will try it. So now we try something different, putting bismuth in it. Bismuth is a large atom, so maybe putting bismuth will change the structure of the nanomaterials, nanocrystals. And here we've done a lot more cycles, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 nanocycles. So we are getting the red curve, and you see every time we load and deload the hydrogen, we increase the excess heat. And at one point, we decided to do like our friends from Japan, Takahashi, who oxidizes his powder. So we oxidize the powder in the calorimeter by putting air instead of putting hydrogen. And there is this is happening at the double red line. And you see, as soon as we oxidized it, the excess heat increased even more. So after, I don't know, the thing is, when do you stop an experiment? That's a good question. I never know the answer. When you're tired of the same one after a few months of running it. So we finally stopped it. After 8, I didn't have enough room to put more curves. So I stopped there. But you see, we almost reached 3 watts of excess heat. And the oxidation seemed to play a role. I don't know what the role is. I'm an experimentalist. I leave it to the theoreticians. So it's about 28 watts per 100 grams, whereas we had 6 watts before and 16 grams before. So it's better. I don't know if it is due to the bismuth or it is due to the oxidation, both maybe. Anyway, I'll show you now some pictures. Okay, now, my question was, is this a real effect or this is a problem with the calorimeter? So I decided to do a blank with a number of cycles, the same way I do with the regular experiments. So I put zirconium oxide in it, under vacuum, under hydrogen, and you see that there's no effect by loading and deloading. So it is not a calorimeter issue, it's really a real effect. So we analyze the powder with electron microscopy and also with XRD. And we find the nickel peaks, which are really well defined. And we discovered some new peaks. You can see at the bottom, very small peaks, but something unknown, which sounds familiar with this field, unknown things. That's why we like it. So this is some micrographs. And you see some nanostructured powder and some crystals, which are quite large, a few microns in diameter, in dimension. And I'll show you blow up. Oh, this is the size of the particles. It's quite big. Now, is it due to the temperature? Because we went up to 950 degrees, or due to the fact there was bismuth in it, or due to the fact that we oxidized? I don't know. But it's between the 20, 50 nanometer range, more than usual. We were more in the 10 nanometer range. Here, a blow up of this crystal. It's, for those who like crystallography, that indicates it's a single crystal with flat size. And so another one, this one is more beautiful even. I'm impressed by this one. Looks like a gem. It's too small for a ring, but it's great. And look at that here. Amazing. I've never seen anything like that so far. I don't know what it is. By analysis, we know that these crystals are actually nickel crystals. Another one. So it's not one of them, there are quite a few of them. The analysis shows that it's only nickel. So this is interesting. Why do we have nickel crystals like that? We didn't see that before in other experiments. Another one. Now you see the bright parts, these are with a lot of bismuth in it. So here you have bismuth in the bright part, and other parts you have nickel. So the bismuth is not distributed evenly in a crystal. The composition is not uniform, some rich in bismuth, some pure nickel. So this is something to think about. Now, calorimeter 1B is the same as 1A, but instead of using homemade resistors, we wanted to use commercial resistors. So we had to struggle for years, at least 2 years, to find a good commercial heat resistor who can go in vacuum at 1000 centigrade without breaking. So we tried a lot of them, and some custom made, and then finally we made them ourselves with wires. Didn't work, they break. So finally the one we found that worked well was the ceramic heaters, and this seems to work very well. So we have worked with that, and so we spent a lot of time trying to find something commercial, and we've reached an excess heat of 2 watts at 900 degrees when hydrogen was pumped out. But it was time to go to the next reactor, the reactor 2, that I will show you now. So we stopped this reaction, this calorimeter, and turned it to a bigger one. The idea is to amplify the phenomenon. In the previous reactors, we are using between 10, 20, 50 grams of powder. And this one reactor can load 800 grams. So we are getting close to applications, at least on paper. This is a similar type of reactor, but more simplified. The flange, instead of being 63 millimeters, 100 millimeters in diameter, it's a CF flange. And the cell is heated with three resistors, same as the other one, but longer. So they have to be custom made because they don't exist on the market. So this is the view of the calorimeter. You see the powder inside. This is for the blank. We put aluminum powder. And then we have three screens on top. And we have screens also on the sides. You don't see them, but there we can pump. But okay. So it's very, we tried it, and now it's being in operation. But we started the experiment, the real experiments, only a few days ago, let's say, a couple of weeks, 3 weeks. And the preliminary results are very encouraging. I cannot tell you more at this point because we are not sure about the results. But hopefully in a few days or weeks we have it. We can have 800 grams. And that's multiplied by at least a factor of 20. So that would be almost, if we are good, if my numbers are correct, we should get something self-sustaining in a few days, maybe. We'll see. Because we can reach high temperature with only 140 watts. So this is calorimeter 3. This is an airflow calorimeter, and the design has been done by a good friend, Jacques Dufour. He built it and designed it and thought about it. Okay, the idea is to have a transpiration chamber. The thing is, in a gas airflow calorimeter, you enter cold air, I mean, the room from the atmosphere, and it gets hot, and you measure the difference between input and output temperature, you know the flow rate, and you can measure the heat produced. Now, the problem is that you have losses. With a transpiration chamber, it's a bit more sophisticated because the airflow goes through another chamber, which is inside, which is a porous chamber. So the air goes inside and goes out from this chamber and not from the first chamber. And inside that chamber, we put a reactor inside a box with wool for insulation. I will show you the picture. So I can measure the temperature inside the reactor, and we can measure the heat flow. And I will show you the calorimeter. It's still at the beginning stage, but I wanted to show this reactor because it's a different type of reactor. And it's good to have two different measurements with different instruments to validate the results. So this is the reactor I'm using at the moment. It's a stainless steel tube, about